Hi there. In this fairly short tutorial, I'm going to show how to create a simple effect such as this. You can see it's basically just curtains and they're sort of opening in a natural looking way. If you want to animate them as closing as well, you'll need to animate that separately, because if you just play it backwards, it doesn't really look quite right. I used this in my Happy Holidays short video and basically rendered it with a transparent background so that I could overlay that on another short video. I'll also show you how to create this sort of velvet curtain texture as well. So to begin with, we need to add a plane as the basis for our cloth simulation. Rotate it on the X, 90, and there we go. I'm going to scale that on the x-axis because obviously this is going to be both halves of the curtain, and just scale it up a little. We can play around with the overall scale in a moment, but one of the main things we want to do is make sure it fills the window. Now it's up to you. If you want curtains that you can see the bottom of, then that's fine. I wanted curtains that sort of went out of the view, but I'll just make it slightly bigger, I think, but about the same aspect ratio as the image, which is a 1080p image. So in the UK we call these curtains. I think in the US they're called drapes. I'm sure there are other names for them in other countries. But what we want to do is divide this into two halves and then have each half move in the opposite direction. So we're going to edit mode and we need to put some more vertices in here in order to be able to simulate cloth. So I'm going to do Control R and you can see I get an edge loop. And then with the mouse wheel I'm just going to add some more loops. Now, obviously the amount you add will affect the quality of the cloth simulation, but at the moment I don't want to add too many. So obviously the number you add will affect the quality of the final cloth simulation, but don't go too mad because you'll just make it more difficult for yourself later. So I'm up to 13 cuts there, so I'm going to go up to 20 cuts. And this is both halves of the curtain, so the half that goes to the right and the left. So I'm just going to subdivide that central one as well, because this is where I'm going to break the two halves apart. So I'm going to select that vertex there and press V and then move my mouse pointer to the right and you can see that moves, and then just press escape to let it go. Do the same to this one, V, and now I can select a vertex on the right hand side, Control L, and you can see I've got the whole half of that curtain. I'm going to push it slightly back from the other curtain and then slightly in so that there's a small overlap. Difficult to see here. One thing that will make it slightly easier to see is if I put ambient occlusion on, and now you can see there's a line down the middle there. This doesn't affect the render, this is just affects the viewport shading. So we've got two flat planes. We also need to subdivide them vertically, and I should probably have done this before I split them, but Control R again and then we'll say 15 and then just press escape just to get a reasonably square piece of curtain. For this simulation it doesn't matter too much, and then the same on this side. So that's the basis for our curtain, and now we need to tell it how it's going to curl up. To make it look more realistic, I need some ripples in my curtain. Select every other line for each of the curtains and just pull them back a little, just to give it a slight sort of ripple. So effectively, where each of these is poking out, that's loose curtain, so it's not fixed to the curtain ring there. So I'm going to select every other vertex. It would be fixed on this end, of course, so I'm going to fix it there as well. You probably want to have an odd number of vertices rather than an even number, but it doesn't matter too much because that would be off screen anyway. I've selected both of the end ones. And then we're going to add a vertex group, and this is going to define the group from which the curtain will hang or be pinned in the cloth sim. So I'm just going to assign that. A to unselect and then click select just to check that it's selected. So I'm just going to now unselect all the ones from this curtain. I'm going to put my 3D cursor there and change the pivot point to 3D cursor. Before I do anything else, I'm going to come out of edit mode and click the plus on shape keys to add basis. So this is our starting shape. Click it again and this is now key one. Now go into edit mode and scale on X, and it's going to just distort that top row. Don't want to change it to zero, but perhaps scale X and I'll just type in 0.25. So I've done it to a quarter of its width. Now come over to this one, do the same. We're still in key one for the shape keys. put the 3D cursor there and scale X 0.25. So it looks pretty strange at the moment. If I turn this relative value up, you can see it sort of pulls everything apart. But that's what we need to happen in order to animate the curtain. So we'll do that now. We'll say at frame 20, so I'll put my pointer there, the value is 0, so I'll press I, which puts a keyframe in, and then somewhere around frame 200, we'll set the value, this is the value for key 1, up to 1, and press I again. Now, the normal interpolation is a sort of curve, which means it's slow to start, speeds up toward the middle, and then slows down again toward the end, and I think that's fine for curtains. So let's see what that does. So you can see it's animating, pulling those vertices back to where we put them. That's what we need for that. And we're now ready to add the cloth simulation. So come over to the physics panel and click cloth. Accept all the defaults to begin with, but one important one is pinning. If I don't click that pinning, all that's going to happen is that my cloth is just going to fall. So click pinning and then click in here and select the group that we created. Now it knows that it needs to hold the curtain up by those vertices. We're not finished with these settings yet, but let's see what that does. And already you can see it's having a go with a limited number of vertices at creating these curtains. So you can see one of the problems is that you do need a reasonable number of vertices for this to work. And because we've now animated it, it's not simple to add more. We can add a subdivision surface, which I've just done with Control 1, and we can try and put that above the cloth simulation. And you can see it's taking a lot longer now. I haven't set this to smooth shading yet, but we're starting to get something that's looking a little bit more like cloth now. Albeit it's a little unsure which direction it should be going. I should probably have made those wrinkles a little better. And we can put the simulation up a level, and we can set it to smooth shading. So when you do this, you may want to add more cuts before you get to the cloth sim. The more cuts you add, the better the cloth sim, but the longer it will take to actually calculate the cloth simulation. There's some things we need to do in here as well. One of those is, under cloth collisions, select self collisions, which means it won't so easily pass through itself. If I start the animation now, you can see there's a bit of settling to begin with, and you can see that's done that. And in terms of the motion, the default settings are not too bad. It's messed up a little bit at the top here because really I needed to pull those vertices a bit further forward to sort of give it a starter for 10 on where to go. But also we can play with some other settings. So I'm just going to turn off the subdivision surface for a moment, which takes us back to our much more primitive curtains. And then we'll just have a look at some of the settings. So overall quality of the simulation you can set here. Very rarely need to change that. Structural and bending are two that you do play with quite a bit. So wrinkle coefficient, higher equals less small but more big wrinkles. So in this case I want big wrinkles in the cloth. So I want a higher bending or wrinkle coefficient. So let's try 1, which is what I used in my other simulation. And you can see it's working quite quickly at the moment because I've turned off the subdivision surface. I also increased the mass, so let's have the mass at 1. So this is obviously the weight of the curtains, because I was trying to simulate very large curtains. If you want your curtains to sort of float around in the wind a lot more, you can play around with these settings. So we could put the mass down to a very low amount. Alternatively, there are some quite good options in here. So if we wanted silk curtains, for example, we can put this in here, and now you'll see that it will tend to float around quite a lot more. You can see the mass is very low here, and there's very little springiness. So here we've got damping on velocity. So if we put this to something like 0.5, I'm just really showing you here what these different settings are going to do. Bearing in mind we're still in low poly mode at the moment, you can see the curtain sort of stays where it is a little bit, which does tend to pull the bottom up, which would be an issue if these were simulating very large curtains. Once you're roughly happy with it, what you can do is bake the simulation. So before I do that, I'm going to put the subdivision surface back on. go to my cloth cache, and by the way, make sure that if your animation is 250 frames, that starts at frame 0 and ends at frame 250, that's what your cloth cache ends at. If your main animation is going on outside of that, then your cloth sim won't be active beyond these limits in here. And that's the case for most of the cache-based simulations. So if I bake that now, okay, so that's baked. And you can see we still got these sort of floaty curtains. But once the curtain starts to catch up, we start to get some nice looking curtains. So I'm going fairly quickly. I'm not putting as much work into this as I did with my original curtains. But what we now need to do is obviously put a bit of texturing on it. So I'm just going to add a lamp, which is going to be a spot lamp. I'm going to rotate it 150, something like that. Put it about the center and down here. So the idea is they're sort of footlights. And I used a value of about 500 because spotlights are relatively dim. I'm going to be adding some more in a moment. So in rendered view, we've just got a very basic curtain right now. I'm going to set the size of the lamp to 0.05, and we don't need that many bounces. We'll set it to 256. And about 0.25 for the blend, which is the softness at the edge of the lamp. So we'll go to the node editor up here, select our curtains, go to material and say new. I don't want the diffuse at all. I'm going to add a shader, which is the velvet shader. For this one, I'm going to set the color to quite a deep blue and the sigma to 0.545. It's hard to explain what these do, so I'll just connect it up. There you see we've just got a dark blue curtain, and as I play around with sigma, it reflects more light and less light. So the values I used were 0.545. It's entirely up to you what you use. So that's the starting point. Duplicate that velvet shader, but set it to a nice bright scarlet red color. And I put the sigma on this one up to about 0.79. Added a mix shader, put that into there. And now to differentiate between one and the other, add a layer weight node, set to a blend of about 0.4, and connect that into here. Now to begin with, it doesn't do an awful lot because I've only got one light in the scene right now. But the idea is that depending on where the light is hitting the curtain and then bouncing into the camera, you will either get the blue velvet color or the red velvet color, and that'll show up more in a moment. But we also want to just add the usual glossy. So just adding another mix shader, add the glossy into there, set this to about 0.015, make sure the glossy is full white, and leave the default roughness on. So that just gives us a little bit of shine. You can use Fresnel or facing, it's up to you. They sort of work almost from the opposite end. But we need to add some more light into the scene now. So we'll come out of rendered view, select my lamp, and then I'm going to do Alt-D, which means I create a copy such that if I change any of the parameters for the original copy, the original lamp or any of the lamps, they'll all maintain the same parameters. I had quite a few, it's up to you, and you can see they overlap with their lights. So it's Alt-D, and I'm just dragging them along. And I also added a couple of plane lights. You can see how we're getting highlights that are more red and highlights that are more purpley blue. And we're even getting the glossy show up down here as well, which is quite fun. And if you want to add a bit more general light, you can either add it to the background, or what I actually did was just add a plane. Just going to change that to median point, rotate X90. Move it back, take the Z, and add a texture, which is an emission shader, set it to about 15, and full white. And I actually put another one over here as well, a little bit smaller and much dimmer. And that just gives us a bit more light in the scene. And of course, if you wanted to, you can actually add a color to the glossy as well. So rather than just reflecting white light, you can reflect a color. So I might go with, say, the blue. And then finally, when you actually render, in order to get a transparent background, and we'll go into all the usual render output settings, do make sure you click the little clock, which would make it use a different seed for each frame. Make sure you select RGBA, which means it's RGB plus the alpha channel. Typically, I get more success using 16-bit color depth for alpha backgrounds. And then finally, make sure under the film section that you click transparent. And you can see the black has disappeared. And that's really all there is to it. So I hope you found that useful. If you did, let me know. If you enjoy these tutorials, don't forget to click like and subscribe. I've just started a Facebook channel. If you want to join that, I'll put a link in the description. And I hope you had a great new year. And I'll see you in the next tutorial. Thanks a lot.